Ladies and gentlemen, please welcome to the stage, Jim Zemlin.
Good morning, everyone. I hope you're having a great week. We have a great lineup for you today. Before we get started, I have a couple of announcements. One, we have an evening event at the Seattle Aquarium tonight. It starts at 6 p.m. Buses will be departing from the lobby downstairs at 5:45 p.m. There is plenty of outdoor space so that we can make sure that we are safe. So Monday, I mentioned that on the 30th anniversary of Linux, Linux is the most widely deployed software in the world. But our next speaker is likely going to correct me in that it's not just Earth, Linux is also on Mars. This year, Linux went to Mars as part of the Perseverance Rover EDL camera system. And as everyone witnessed, the Mars helicopter. Many of you did contribute that code. Many of you have badges, little tags on your badge that indicate that. Our next speaker is going to provide an overview of those actual systems that were used on Mars. He is the software and operations lead for the Mars helicopter at NASA's Jet Propulsion Laboratory. Please welcome Tim Canham.
All right, well, good morning, everyone, both here and virtually. And it's very exciting to be here. As Jim mentioned, I attended his keynote earlier this week, and he talked about how Linux was exploding all over the internet. Well, it's exploded over the solar system and is now on Mars. So that's very cool. And it seems appropriate that on the 30-year anniversary of Linux, it's operating on Mars. So I have a presentation. This is a fun one, so relax and enjoy it. It's going to talk about Linux on Mars. So first of all, let me give a brief background who I am. I am a senior software engineer at the Jet Propulsion Laboratory, and I worked on a number of projects. And interestingly enough, we talk about the 30-year anniversary of Linux. It's also my 30-year anniversary of working at JPL. I came out of school as a wide-eyed young graduate, going to work for JPL, the hallowed halls that had produced the Mariners and the Vikings and the Voyagers. For those of you who are probably older like me, V'ger, remember that? And, so coming into that place, young and impressionable, and here I am 30 years later, and being part of this exciting project that's the Mars helicopter. So I worked on these different projects when I was first out of school. I worked in the Deep Space Network, which is a, that's me, by the way, in case you couldn't pick me out of the crowd. That's when I was in our, when we were in our bunny suits, we call them the bunny suits, in the huge spacecraft assembly facility at JPL. You can see the rover, the Perseverance rover in the background, and we were testing the helicopter. But I started my career working in the Deep Space Network, which is this array of antennas in three different locations around the world, so it can see all of the solar system and talk to spacecraft. And I worked on Cassini, which is the Saturn spacecraft that just finished its mission a few years ago, and it was an amazing spacecraft. And then Curiosity, that's really where I cut my teeth on writing flight software. And I wrote a lot of the flight software that was on the Curiosity rover, which is still operating after 13 or 14 years. And a lot of that software is now on Perseverance. So I have software operating in a sense on the Perseverance rover and on the helicopter. And then for Ingenuity, as the introduction mentioned, I am the flight software lead. So I led a team of software developers and also the operations lead. Now that's a little different in that we had to design ground tools to process the data that we got from the helicopter and to plan how we would operate the helicopter. I'm also the architect of the F-Prime flight software framework. That'll be in a later slide that I'll show you, but that's the software that we use to operate the helicopter. And a little Linux history is back when I first joined Curiosity, JPL was very much a Solaris house, and they wanted to keep that going. But even back then, probably in the 2005-2006 range, I saw where the market was going, and I convinced them to switch to Linux. for our flight software development, and then that soon propagated throughout the flight project to the point where now Perseverance uses a lot of Linux. It's pretty much standardized on Linux running in VM instances. So I played a small role in trying to get Linux and successfully getting Linux to be the operating system of choice for flight projects at JPL. So there is Perseverance. You can see a selfie they took. You can see the helicopter on the ground behind it. And Perseverance's mast cam kind of looking at us and looking at the helicopter. So here's a picture of the helicopter. This is what was taken after the helicopter was dropped on the surface by the rover. It was a close-up. The helicopter stands about this tall, you know, about 3/4 of a meter. Its blades tip to tip are about 1.2 meters. And the whole vehicle weighs about 4 pounds on Earth. We had to build it very lightweight with carbon fiber just so it could fly with the weight of the batteries and the weight of the system. So it's very lightweight. Everything is tiny. There's a lot of commercial hardware, and there's a lot of custom hardware as well. So here's a picture, if you will, of the two computer systems that we flew. So the helicopter on the right, you can see a cube there. That's the four avionics boards that we fly. It's beneath that gold foil cover on the helicopter. But not only did we have to write the flight software for that computer, but we also had to write flight software for what's called the base station. It's actually an instrument payload on the rover that is used to talk to the rover on one side, and then through the radio, it talks to the helicopter. And the radio system we use is good old Zigbee. We hacked it up a little bit, the protocol, to make it work better for us. But it's really a Zigbee radio, and it's performed extremely well. I wanted to show you something. This is a box that contains, this is serial number 102. It's got a processor board inside. It was tested and failed during testing, and because we manhandled it a little bit. Serial number 103 is on Mars, so this one missed it just barely. So I wanted to show you what that looked like. This is a picture of the computer that is running Linux on the surface of Mars. So it's running not only on the helicopter, but it's also running on that base station that I mentioned. So we developed software for it. You can see it's very tiny, but very, very powerful. This computer is on the order of 150 times more powerful than the computer that runs on the rover itself. So there's a lot of power in a very small processor and runs Linux, so that's very cool. I wanted to show everybody that so you could see what that looks like. So that's a good view of the boxes that we designed. Let me give you a little block diagram of what they look like. You can see there on the top you can see the processor board that came as part of a kit before we disassembled it to put it on the helicopter. It's a Qualcomm Snapdragon, which is an ARM processor, quad core, 2.2 gigahertz, it has 2 gig of RAM, and 32 gigabytes of eMMC memory that we use for our file system. Has two cameras. There's a Sony IMX on the top that we use to take color pictures. So if you've seen the website with the color pictures, that's the Sony took that. And then there's an OmniVision machine vision camera that points down towards the surface. And that camera, we take images 30 times a second as we're flying, and we do feature tracking from image to image. So you can see features move from frame to frame. That's one of the sensors that we use for our navigation. And so you'll see some of the black and white pictures. Every once in a while, by command, we'll grab one of those pictures as they go by and save them to storage, and then you can see those black and white pictures when we transport them down to the surface. It also has a micro semi pro ASIC. That's a rad hard FPGA that has some special logic for running the motors. It also acts as a mediator to the guidance sensors we have. We actually have a Garmin LiDAR that we bought from SparkFun, literally bought from SparkFun. That's our altimeter. We have a Bosch IMU that's very popular in the cell phone world for gyroscopic sensing. We have an inclinometer. That's a very slow-moving device that tells us what our initial tilt is when we're on the ground. And, of course, we have the Zigbee radio that I mentioned earlier. But we also have a TI microcontroller. It's a really tough automotive controller that does a lot of our guidance because it's basically got all these memory protections and hardware protections that makes it a very reliable processor. So between those two processors, between the Linux running on Snapdragon and then we're running bare metal on the MCU, between the two of them, they cooperate and we run a guidance loop at 500 times a second. So there's a lot of data moving very quickly because we have to have that high level of control over the helicopter because the air is very thin. It's about 1% of Earth's air, so we have to be able to control it very finely. So let's look at some of the layers. So Linux, for those of you who want version numbers, we're running Linaro 3.4. It was built by the Yocto project back at Qualcomm. They delivered that as part of a BSP for the board. It's really sort of a Linux-Android hybrid. It presents itself as Linux. You can shell into it. You run it as Linux processes. But some of the drivers are from the Android world. And we actually used ADB to do a lot of our testing. We would shell in under ADB and run tests and scripts and so forth. The Canham drivers actually came with the BSP. They were delivered software by Qualcomm, so we didn't have to spend a lot of time developing that. We actually modified it. I put that if you can see that little green line down there. The camera that I mentioned earlier, the black and white camera that takes pictures of the surface as we're flying, we needed to know when in time those pictures are taken so we can run them through our guidance algorithm and know when the picture was taken. So we actually modified the camera driver to pulse a GPIO whenever a picture was taken, and then the FPGA adds a time tag to it so we can know exactly when it was taken. We really used the kernel drivers. We didn't write any of our own kernel drivers. We just had user space access to those drivers, and we basically run it as a user space application as root, so it can access all these different driver interfaces. So it was conventional Linux embedded hobbyist development. Because we had Linux with all the standard drivers, we were able to just use them. It was made our lives a lot easier. We didn't have to do a lot of custom hardware development. So here's a picture of all the modules. The helicopter application itself runs using the F-Prime open source flight software framework. That's a framework that our group at JPL has developed over the years. I was one of the original architects. You can actually go to GitHub and look at that repository. Just search for F-Prime, and you can download it and run a demo on a Raspberry Pi or Linux or Mac if you want, just to get an idea. But many of the components in that repository are components that flew on Mars. And it's a Tinker Toy style component architecture. Just try to imagine blocks of software that you connect at runtime with wires. It's a good analogy to hardware, and it allows us to mix and match and do different combinations depending on what we're doing, testing or the actual flight deployment. It inherits code from previous JPL missions, so there are much of the code we didn't really even have to test again. We just able to use it. It's been extremely reliable. You can see a color code over here on the right. These are the names of the modules that we wrote. The green ones were ones we inherited from other projects, so we didn't have to write. And then the purple ones were ones we shared between the helicopter and the base station that I mentioned earlier. And then the orange ones were ones that we had to write uniquely for the helicopter system itself. So as the helicopter boots up, it broadcasts telemetry live every second. But we also, during the flight, write data to buffers in memory, and then when the flight is done, we flush those buffers to storage, and then we transfer those just as files back to the rover, and then the rover transfers them to the ground, and then we can decode them using our ground tools. They get very detailed logs of what actually went on during the flight. Because the treasure trove of this project is the very fine-grained performance data that we took during the flight. So we have 6 redundant copies, so our startup scripts, we use upstart scripts in the standard kind of Linux way, and then we have 3 copies of our flight software that are examined by that script to make sure they pass checksums, and then it picks the first one that it encounters that passed, and that's the one it runs. And we can update the software, which we have done, by the way, in flight by uploading a new version And then our routine on the helicopter makes three copies and then points to the new copy. And so obviously everything up to that is not protected, because, and we don't have any ability to update the actual Linux kernel in flight, just the flight software itself. So how do we use Linux besides just writing the application? We have actually a flight command, a command we can issue where we just give it a string and it runs whatever we pass it on essentially the command line of bash on the actual helicopter. So we use the system API call to run that, and it runs locally. So we've used it as part of our flight sequences to do things like compress a log file. We have these big files with a radio that doesn't have a lot of data bandwidth. And so we've actually take these big logs after a flight and we compress them with bzip. We just run them through bzip and it compresses them down to a much more manageable size before we try to transfer them. And we use MD5 sum to checksum the images so that once we get them on the ground, because it goes through several hops, by the time it gets to us, we can confirm that the file that we actually got on the ground matches the one that's on the vehicle. And we do file listings so we can get estimates of size that tells us how long it will take us to transfer later on. And we use typical utilities like RM to do cleanup. And we actually ended up using TaskSet on this to actually run some of these bzip tasks, because we want to run it on a different core than the one that's actually stroking the watchdog. Because if we, some of these file system activities would clog up that core enough that we could trigger the watchdog timer. So we actually ended up running them on a separate core. So we used a bunch of these command line utilities to actually operate the spacecraft after the landing to do our data management. So how busy is the system? Here's a nice plot that I like to show. We're recording once a second how busy the CPUs are, basically the CPU utilization. We have commands to lower and raise the performance of the cores. We can up the clock or lower the clock depending if we want to save power. So we crank them all on during the flight. You can see that jaggy area where the flight is pointing to, where the different cores, we have tasks pinned to the cores to do the flight algorithms and imaging and the feature tracking that I talked about. So they're all pretty busy during the flight, but they're still, if you can see that they're still sitting around 40 to 50% utilization. That's how powerful this little processor is compared to what we're used to. And then after that's done, we lower the processor clocks to save energy. So you can actually see the utilization goes up. You can see those spikes when we're writing all these logs to disk, and then the spikes, the red spikes, when we actually run bzip. It uses the processor a lot because it's writing to storage. So that's just a cool picture to show how this processor is working during and after a flight. Another cool thing is that there's another box on the rover that was the rover EDL camera system. So this is not part of the helicopter system, but it's a instrument payload on the rover that actually took video as the rover was landing. And these exploded over the internet because they're pretty amazing pictures. JPL has never been able to get really detailed video of its own landing ever until now. And they did it basically by running this what they call the EDL camera system during the landing. It wasn't involved in guidance. You can think of it as a DVR of the landing. And it's more of a conventional PC than the helicopter. It's basically a ruggedized Intel Atom PC. And they ran USB cables all over the spacecraft with USB hubs. And they used an FTDI chip to talk to the rover via UART, just a good old-fashioned FTDI. Anybody who's done embedded programming has probably used one of those. And it's running the 4.1.5 kernel of Linux. And they use a bunch of open source software right on the computer, including FFmpeg, and they even have Python scripts that are running to do the image processing. You can see there pictures of the computer, a ruggedized USB hub, and then the cameras, they're just USB 2 and USB 3 cameras, and they're commercial cameras. They just repackage them to make them more rugged. Here's a block diagram. You have the descent stage, where you had these downward pointing cameras to watch as the rover was unspooled towards the ground. And you had the rover, which had what they call the uplook cameras, which showed the descent stage going away. And the top of the descent stage had pictures. You see the billowing parachutes. And so they basically had a gigabit Ethernet from the one computer. You see the descent storage unit, that was one computer. And then the descent storage unit one on the rover itself, they were basically during the landing, they were quickly as they could sending images from one to the other because the stages separate during landing and you wouldn't have access to that upper computer when they landed. Here's some nice pictures of that. You can see the yellow circle that shows the landing stage cameras that were looking down at the rover as it was descending. That pic, you can see an example of that picture in the lower left. And likewise, you can see the in the yellow lines on the lower left picture, you can see the cameras that looked up at the descent stage. And all these different cameras as they were mounted around the vehicle and they could take video of the landing. So that was pretty exciting too. It was just a x86 Linux box that was taking a bunch of USB cameras and just dumping them to storage as they landed. And it, as you can see, the pictures were pretty epic. Here's some more pictures of the hardware as it was mounted, the USB cables as they went through different parts of the vehicle, how they mounted the computers on the superstructure of the rover. And basically the premise was we'll take all this video as we landed and we'll take whatever we get since it's not really involved in the landing process itself. Everything we get from those landing videos is a bonus. And it was spectacular. I'm sure some of you saw those videos. So Linux played a great role in that as well. So to close here, what are our conclusions about Linux? Linux really boosted our ability to develop quickly for the helicopter and I would say for the EDL cameras. We had standard I/O drivers. We got a BSP from the manufacturer so we didn't have to develop any of the hardware drivers. And the shell and the ADB interface made our testing much easier. We could easily copy new versions of the software on there. And we actually used Wi-Fi, USB, and the like for our testing and connecting our testing equipment. It's kind of funny that the helicopter is still on Mars trying to find our router. Wi-Fi is still pinging trying to find our router. But it's sadly not finding it because it would be a lot faster than our radio. But anyway, and I'd say Linux did very well. As long as you're aware of what its limitations were. We did not have a real-time version of Linux. The real-time patch was not available for our version of the kernel from Qualcomm. We had preempt, but we did not have the real-time patch. It just happened, it was so fast, it still kept up. And you need to avoid file I/O during critical moments because the file subsystem can sometimes, you know, hose up a core or whatever and cause problems with our cycling of our guidance. So that's why we put everything in memory and then to disk. And we used the partitioning of the file system to protect our software and to provide areas that, you know, they can only grow so much in terms of log files so we wouldn't spill over. So we were able to just use normal Linux utilities to do all these things. So it really was a benefit. And I think the future of Linux in space is very rosy. I think that the helicopter and the EDL cam really served to pave the way to make the space industry trust Linux more because they're very used to proprietary RTOSes, but having Linux perform so well as it has on the helicopter and EDL camera has really given it a leg up. So keep your eyes on what's going on. There's a web page for the helicopter where you can look at images that we're taking. We're still flying. The helicopter is still very healthy. And so I hope you get a chance to go on the web page and enjoy what we're doing going forward. So thank you very much.
That was awesome. Really good. I have one quick question for you.
Sure.
One of the things that struck me back there when you were going through the copter BSP was how relatively like generic a lot of it was.
Yeah.
That's kind of out there for anyone to use. Like you were pretty practical about not really modifying that much stuff in there.
And that really helped us because that was something we didn't have to do. And we didn't have to lose the experience of all the open source developers or refine it for us. If you go on the F-Prime repo, the UART drivers, the SPI drivers, the GPIO drivers are the exact same ones that are flying in the helicopter.
That's so,
so
cool.
You can use them on your own projects. You can put it on a Raspberry Pi, run a little gyroscope, whatever you want to do, and it'll be much of the same code that's running on the helicopter.
That's awesome. Super cool. Thank you for coming today.
You're welcome.
That was a wonderful presentation.
Our next speaker is someone who has an extremely rarefied skill set. You know, in open source projects and in, you know, working on big code efforts, you know, we always talk about developers who are really the heroes and the people who get the work done. But there's also another group of folks who work in helping establish the structure of a community so that people can come in, quickly get productive, help coordinate the collaboration between an organic open source project and industry who are paying employees to work in those open source projects. And in particular, for like a big mega project like a Kubernetes or an Nginx or a MySQL, you need these kind of people to take those projects from, you know, just a repo in someone's you know, small group to a massive, you know, tens of thousands person effort. Sarah Novotny is one of those people that possesses that rare skill. Today, she's in the office of the CTO at Microsoft. She previously served on the Linux Foundation Board of Directors in her role at Google. She then left Google and is now at Microsoft, and then came back onto the Board of Directors. And for the record, you don't get two retirement gifts if you go from one to another. But we are really grateful to have her today to speak with us all. Please welcome Sarah Novotny.
Good morning, folks. It's really strange to be out in a conference, in an event, talking to people. It's been, for most of us, 18 months, 20 months since we did something like this. So for me, this is a really personal event, and I wanted to do this talk that way. It'll certainly cover all of Microsoft things and all of that, but hopefully it'll be less rote than some of the talks that we have seen over the many years. So I want to talk about hats and how we grow. Those are the two topics. So in open source, when we're working in our communities, in our groups, in our little special interest groups, in our technical advisory groups, in our projects, we spend a lot of time offering positions on behalf of different roles that we have. So sometimes I'm on the Linux Foundation board talking with Jim about being a Linux Foundation member. Sometimes I'm here in a Linux Foundation event and I'm talking to the great Jillian Hall, who helped me get all of the things ready for this talk. And I am here as a volunteer. I'm not here as a board member. I'm here to do work. I do work on the board too, but sometimes different. So let's talk about all these different hats. And let's start with the tinfoil one, because that's super important as we talk about open source and as we talk about open source right now. We've spent the last 18 months not having our regular checkpoints with our communities, not spending that quick 30 minutes of serendipity and checking in with someone who maybe didn't offer you the review that you thought you needed on that particular pull request. And so you start making up these stories. Humans are great storytellers, fantastic storytellers. And if we don't have data, we make up stories. We make up stories in our head. Oh, I didn't get that phone call last night like I was supposed to. Maybe they don't like me. Maybe they aren't going to call me back. But our human nature is such that we need to understand why things happen. And so we make up stories. Without these regular checkpoints over the last year, year and a half now, I think a lot of different communities inside open source broadly are struggling to have empathy and to align interests with people who are sometimes competitors, are sometimes collaborators, are sometimes just a peer group that understand how to speak open source. So I really hope that many of you take off your tinfoil hats and instead work with me in a pirate mode. Let's go in and disrupt. Let's go into these communities. Let's hold people accountable. Let's not look for the hierarchies. Let's go ahead and make sure that we are holding people as peers accountable, don't wait until you have to reach out to a leader in order to make a change in a project. Make that change yourself. Make that change by saying, we don't do that here, or I think maybe this person isn't understanding what you're asking, and help. Help lead that collaboration. You're all leaders in these projects, and you have that opportunity to make that change. So in my pirating days today, I want to talk about one of my favorite people in open source, who has decided to go on at least a very long hiatus from open source at the moment. So this is John Gossman, and many of you know John. John has just retired from Microsoft and is one of the reasons I am here on stage talking about Microsoft, talking about open source. But I wanted to talk specifically about what I saw in John and how I learned from him. So first we have to start, always think about what hat we're wearing, when we're working, and then how we're engaging with our communities. So John was part of the Microsoft apology tour, as he described it. As we started making more and more efforts with open source and continued to move out into the world, along with all of the leadership change with Satya, we had a full culture change. And one of the things that needs to be left and respected and understood in a culture change is there is more to learn. There's always more to learn from whomever you're working with. And making sure that you have the space to respect that person's experience, different perspective, previous lived history, experiences even in the same conversation that you have. Having a respect for that different experience is incredibly important. And that quiet, consistent respect and ability to empathize with someone else's perspective is one of the things that I treasured in John's leadership. One of the other things that I treasured in his leadership was his curiosity. He's been gone from Microsoft only about 2 weeks, 3 weeks. 3 weeks. And his curiosity already has him trying to figure out what he's going to do next and has had him get multiple requests to come back and join technology again. But his curiosity and his ability to take anything he learns and look at everything he works on today through that new perspective and connect those dots is incredibly important in how we all work. This group is very much the type of people who look at the future and say, there's some good here we can do. So take that curiosity, and I'll use a quote from one of my favorite lawyers in the world, or formerly of the world. Ruth Bader Ginsburg says, lead, and lead in a way that encourages others to follow. So with your curiosity, when you're drawing connections between something new you learned or sudden understandings of statistics because COVID has made it completely real for us, when you take those things and you learn them and you gather a new insight, share that insight. Connect it to other things you work on. Ask other people to engage with you on it. Get more perspectives. Ask for some different perspective. Ask for someone else to share with you why they do this differently. And use that curiosity to enable and empower you through serendipity and novelty. Those two things, I think, are the two things that as a world we've had a most difficult time managing in the last year and a half. Now, serendipity and novelty are different from it was thrust upon me, and it's different, but it's uncertain. Novelty has a fun side to it. Novelty is exciting. Novelty draws you in. Serendipity is running into someone you haven't seen in a year in the hallway and having that perfect conversation because you had that moment and that focus. So use your curiosity to impart, even in the world that we have at the moment, which is so very digital and so very separated, to impart that novelty and that serendipity into the world. Maybe it's a cold call to your parents. Maybe it's an outreach to someone you haven't talked to because you worked with them 10 years ago, but you thought of them the other day. Take those opportunities to connect people when you think of something new, when you think of a connection. And the last thing that I'm going to talk about here specifically is the quality of listening. We spend so much time each day broadcasting or pulling together our next statement to respond to someone. Take the time to listen. Take the time to reflect back what you hear. And then, as you reflect it back, learn from it. Engage with people. Understand that they're going to experience something completely differently than you because they have a different life story. All of these things were fundamental to my experience coming into Microsoft and seeing the underpinnings of all of this culture change that we've had over the last 10 years, a little less than 10, since Satya became CEO. Which leads me to my little fun announcement. I am actually the new John Gossman. Our team remains together, and we continue to do the work that we have been doing. We still live and exist in the Azure office of the CTO and work very broadly across Microsoft on almost anything open source where someone needs help or support inside or outside on a project that they're working on. One of the reasons I'm so excited about Microsoft, which, let me be clear, I lived in Seattle for 20 years and moved away before I considered working at Microsoft. I was as surprised as all of you that I work at Microsoft. But one of the reasons I feel confident that Microsoft will make a big impact in open source over time, with ups and downs, the same way anyone does when learning, or any organization does while learning, is because we have such a focus on this culture. The Azure Office of the CTO has their three H's, which is to be humble. First and foremost, we are here to learn, we are here to help, and we want to make sure that our capacity in open source is growing just as much as we are helping in open source. So that's first. Let's be humble. Let's be helpful. And this is a great, important piece that needs to happen. A lot of the work that our teams do across Microsoft in open source are about being helpful. And then there's the third H. And depending on if you're talking about the entire office of the CTO or just our open source strategy and ecosystem team, that third H is a little bit different. For the CTO's office, that third H is hands-on. So you'll find us in and involved and engaged in open source. You'll find us in and involved and engaged in helping Microsoft do better in open source and growing new leaders. On the open source ecosystem team, that third H actually stands for mostly harmless. Mostly. And we say that because we know that culture change is hard. And culture change hurts sometimes. And you need to understand that people will experience it differently. And getting to a space where everyone has the ability to work to their greatest capacity and they're empowered to do interesting and exciting and innovative things in the world, then we're going forward. And then we feel that we are meeting our mission. So there's a few things that are super straightforward that we're holding as anchors in this. One, every customer-facing role at Microsoft is an open source strategy ambassador. So that means everyone at Microsoft needs to understand where we are trying to go with open source, why we're trying to work in open source, and how we actually focus to work and accomplish efforts against the hard problems that are bigger than any one organization. One of the ways this happens is through all of the work from our OSPO and in the work that our OSPO does to help other people make OSPOS, to help others understand how OSPOS work, and how we document and publish all this information. Opensource.microsoft.com is a great spot for that information. And we've had a really wonderful announcement this week, because there's going to be, or there is a program now, to offer Azure credits to open source projects who want to do integration and compiling and development on Azure and include Azure in their build pipelines. We also are investing deeply in the OpenSSF. We're going to hear lots more about them in another couple of minutes. As the next talk, we have Kate Stewart and David Wheeler joining us to talk in depth about OpenSSF. But this is where the entire industry needs to come together and find best efforts, find new ways and tooling that we can go ahead and make our open source world more secure. And then we need to understand how that propagates out to all of the projects that we depend on, all of the projects that we work on, and all of the projects that we have influence on. Lastly, let me talk about hats again. When we wear little hats, when we wear hats and talk about what we're doing, maybe I'm wearing a hat as a Linux Foundation board member, maybe as a Microsoft executive, maybe as an individual, as this talk is. But always, we want to be building communities and building a place to hang hats. Leslie Hawthorne wrote a great post about this, probably about 10 years ago now, and making something that we can all be proud of and we can all point to and say, this changed the industry, is what we're looking to do, what we need to do to handle these challenges. We can't do this without being hands-on. We can't do this without asking for feedback and understanding, absorbing, and reflecting even the hard feedback. Because, oh my God, it's been a hard week, and we're still learning. So continue to help us at Microsoft and all of your peers in open source understand your perspective, understand your needs, understand what your agenda is within a project, and then how you want space made for you in that project. Work with these communities to deliver larger things than any one of our companies or communities could deliver alone. And you all are the leaders that can do that. So please go out into your communities, guide them, encourage them, help them be empathetic and work together, and then let's really make an impact on the industry. Thanks.
Done. Well done. Wait one second. I have a question for you.
You have a question. Okay.
In so many meetings, I love that. I love the hats.
Yes.
People always in meetings, particularly when I first started this job, I'm taking off this hat, I'm putting on this hat. And I love the way you think about that. I remember the first time I realized what a great open source project was, is when Linux developers would primarily say, I'm a Linux person, and then secondarily they'd say, oh, and this is my company hat. Yeah. Which was super cool and only awkward in the case of the poor Red Hat folks.
Yes.
Where they were taking off their Linux hat and putting on their Red Hat hat.
It was always, which just didn't sound right.
It was just a little goofy. Yeah. But amazing. You do great work.
Thank you
for coming and presenting today.
Have a lovely day.
All right. Our next two speakers are some of my favorite people at the Linux Foundation. We also use the Triple H at the Linux Foundation. Humble, helpful, hopeful. An optimism that we have to have in order to do the kind of work we do at the Linux Foundation. Kate Stewart and David Wheeler are two of the people who epitomize that ethos. Starting with Kate, who came to the Linux Foundation in 2015 to work on some various legal initiatives, on our software bill of materials efforts. And we realized that Kate also has expertise in embedded systems. So she said, I'm going to go work on this Yocto thing. And then she said, hey, I'm into real-time operating systems, so I'm going to go work on Zephyr as well.
And it's just been amazing to see her leadership at the Linux Foundation in some of these really important projects. Yocto, for example, you just heard, you know, that was what they used to build the system for the helicopter on Mars. So she is just an amazing all-around person. The second person who's coming out is David Wheeler. David joined the Linux Foundation a few years ago to work on security initiatives here. And, you know, for those of you who are in the security industry, it may not surprise you that folks in security tend to be pretty cynical. Except for David Wheeler. He is one of the most optimistic, kind, good-natured people I know. They're gonna come and talk to us today about supply chain security. Please welcome to the stage, Kate Stewart and David Wheeler.
Hello, welcome. One of the things we'd like to talk to you about is, well, my name's Kate Stewart, and this is David. And we're here to talk to you about the need for all of us to work together to improve the automation around supply chain transparency and security. You know, software today is often built with a combination of open source and proprietary. And more you'll see stats everywhere on this type of subject. And what this has enabled is developers are able to reuse and build on the packages created by others. And so innovation, like what you were seeing in our first keynote, becomes possible. And this rapid creation of new technologies and capabilities is exciting for all of us. However, that rapid innovation and building on and building on and building on has a bit of a problem, shall we say, in the sense that there are dependencies. We all depend on dependencies. And this cartoon from XKCD came out last year and pretty much summarizes the supply chain problem beautifully. Now, a supply chain is a set of dependencies upon dependencies upon dependencies. And software has evolved to be organized into packages so that everyone isn't re-implementing the same functionality over and over. It's efficient. Being able to call a library or a package, it's all baked into our ecosystem. However, those dependencies don't necessarily all stay updated at the same rate, nor do they have the same level of support levels. So in that XKCD cartoon, you will see there's that dependency hidden way down under all those containers or whatever on a package that some person has thanklessly been maintaining in Nebraska since 2003. So having that transparency about the softwares is going to be needed to actually understand what's being used to run the application, what you depend on, and the accurate and authentified identification of all that related software and the package dependencies is key to preventing software supply chain attacks. So we really need to figure out how we can have that full transparency so we don't need to worry about that guy from Nebraska's package. So let's talk about transparency and security. For us, our purpose here is transparency is, you know, knowing what's there and can it be communicated effectively and accurately. Security is ensuring that it's being used in a secure fashion and distributed securely so no one's tampering with it. So I'm going to talk about the transparency, and David's going to talk about security. So to get to efficient software transparency at scale, we need to standardize processes and practices to share the information. I can't say that enough. For us to automate across an entire ecosystem at scale, we need that standardization available to us. We need to know what we're getting. We need to know where it's come from, what the risk is. You know, if I use this, am I going to get into trouble a bit? Is someone going to keep it up to date? All these things are valid concerns. And if we're going to distribute it further, you know, have we paid attention to our obligations? So for us to get all this to work, again, at scale, we've got to automate wherever possible. So moving ourselves forward with this, making that efficient. You know, you can do all these things manually. It's soul destroying, but you can do it manually. And no one really wants to be unhappy here. So there's been initiatives over the last 10 years or so, and they're finally starting to mature. For the processes from one company to another company, which is a large part of our ecosystem, there's open chain. And that determines what the best practices are for sharing software. Not just open source, but software in general. And then the other initiative that I've been working on is something called Software Build Materials and the SPDX format, which some of you have heard of, and it actually started here at the Linux Foundation in 2010, is for software package data exchange. So getting this these standards adopted widely means we suddenly can have tooling that consumes and produces and transforms. Now, there are initiatives going on, and these processes are aligning with them. So the European Union Agency for Cybersecurity, the ENISA, has various initiatives on, you know, cybersecurity and best practices there, and then calling for certain SBOM type of information. The NTIA, for the National Telecommunications and Information Administration here in the US, had an SBOM initiative for the last 3 years, and this resulted in references and a reasonably good definition of what we all mean by an SBOM, and some degree of standardization worldwide on that definition. The OSS group has a common security advisory framework. The OpenSSF, which David will talk a lot more about, has an open source vulnerability database that they're working on. And then there's the national vulnerability database. Interacting that transparency with that vulnerability information is what's going to let us work at scale. So one of the things, the Linux Foundation has a research group right now. And over the summer, they did a survey with a whole bunch of businesses, because this term SBOM is floating around. What does it mean? And they wanted to see, you know, how familiar are organizations with the term SBOM? And it turns out that 83% over the summer, especially with all the noise that came up from the executive order, had familiarity with the term. And, you know, we're starting to take actions and starting to pay attention and starting to figure out how to adopt. So that's been a real boost for us to start to get that scale going. So in terms of the processes and practices to share this information, the software information, SPDX actually started in 2010. Wind River's actually been using it with all their products, VxWorks, Linux, and so forth, for over 8 years. And then OpenChain was from one company to another company. How do we actually, you know, share this information, and SBOMs. And so Mark Giese from Wind River actually has been the spec lead on that and making sure that the process has emerged for something that people can actually do. And the first version of OpenChain specification came out in 2016. And so both of these specifications have been evolving over the years. And then last year, OpenChain became an ISO standard. And then this year, a month ago, SPDX has also now become an ISO standard. So we went through the international review so that the tooling base on it could have a base to depend on, and so that tools could interact and exchange information effectively. And so OpenChain's a year ahead of SPDX here, but they've got a pretty wide swath of the ecosystem agreeing to work with their processes and use these processes now. So next thing is to know what you're getting. Okay, you've got that huge big stack. What's in it? Getting software composition analysis tools integrated into workflows. So when you're building an image, same time you get the image, you get the summary, i.e. the SBOM. And if we can get those types of tools there, so it's not in the way of developers, it's not an after the fact. We can do the analysis on the fly, we can reject patches when they don't line up with the criteria that we want to have in our final distributables. This is going to, I think, make us get to scale. But it's step by step, tool by tool, build it up by build it up. And the other one project I'll talk point of view is Turn. And Turn basically sits there and does a lot more of analysis on the containers. those big container blobs, what's actually in there? What packages have been pulled together? Are the drive dependencies? Can we crack it apart? And you know, there's lots of open source, there's lots of proprietary. In the slides, you'll see links to demos of these tools. They're in, you know, they're in use, and they're continuing to evolve. And as they always say, patches are welcome. Continuing on to knowing what you're getting and knowing that we can build it as we do it, we're seeing a wide range of projects themselves adopt build tools to generate these SBOMs. Kubernetes has a bomb tool that they've incorporated. It's now available. The Yocto project. There's prototypes now for generating SPDX SBOMs out of the Yocto builds. And then Zephyr, which is a project I work with as well, has a West tool for doing builds. And right now, it's as simple as going West to SPDX when you're doing your build, and you can get an SBOM. Well, actually, you get four SBOMs. You get one for Zephyr, one for the SDK, one for the app, and one for the binary that links all those pieces together. So you have transparency from the binary to the source file. And that is pretty key when you're working in the embedded space, because if you don't have a file in your image, it can't be vulnerable if someone tells me, oh, there's a bug about it. So knowing where it came from is the next aspect. And improving the transparency and integrity is going to be an increasing focus for these supply chain attacks that we're going to be working our way through. There's two projects that are emerging, SigStore and Intoto, and David will talk more about that. And there's demos there, as well as understanding the security and project health. You know, is it one person in Nebraska that's maintaining a project, or is there a, you know, a team of 1,000? And with, you know, a distributed set of companies, there's one company controlling, or is it a whole, you know, equal community? All of these are factors for determining risk. And so the Chaos project is looking at standardizing these metrics so that we can, you know, tackle this problem at scale. The OpenSSF has a variety of initiatives, and the Core Infrastructure Initiative has been working now for the last 5 years for open source projects and helping open source projects adopt best practices as well. Now, and SPDX itself is actually looking at, you know, creating a profile about vulnerability and defects data, and the standards are continuing to evolve to incorporate this type of information. And then when we're actually shipping it on or passing on the open source, it's a supply chain. Identifying the licenses is a key consideration, since open source is defined by the licenses that's there. And there's various tools out there for doing that. We have standardized on the license identifiers in the ecosystem, and that's got pretty good wide adoption now. And there's tools like Fasology and Reuse that will help you with these types of tasks for identifying your obligations. So for us to automate wherever possible, and we're going to need that to get to scale, you know, before you decide to bring in software, please scan it and have a summarized SBOM available. Before you build it, or as you build it, get the get tools in place to catch the details that make up that final executable, so you have an SBOM for every binary image. And then before you ship it, you know, you may not want to ship all the details, but have an accurate SBOM for what you've added in and what you've integrated in, at least at the first level, for organizations consuming it down the supply chain from you. This is, I think, if we can all sort of work on this as a community, I think we'll finally get there for scale. But, you know, no one person's going to solve this on their own. And quite frankly, the tools are going to get some of these things wrong. So as we design these tools, we need to make it easy for people to interact with their data, correct it, so they can reflect it further. And with that, I will turn it over to more about the supply chain attacks.
Okay, thank you so very much, Kate. So, you know, Kate very much focused on the transparency part. It's obviously very, very important that we know what is within the larger software systems or the overall systems that we develop, that we use. But we want more than just to know what's in it. We want to make sure those are actually secure. We want to make sure that they are implemented as a secure software. We want to make sure that when they're distributed, we get the software that we were expecting. And unfortunately, as several people have actually mentioned throughout this conference, software supply chain attacks are growing. Sonatype did a report this year 2021 report, where they found that there's been a 650% increase year over year in software supply chain attacks. I mean, software supply chain have always been important, but now national governments are discussing it because the problems are becoming so obvious and so serious. And they come from a variety of sources. You know, there's a recent new kind of attack that became, well, at least it became obvious that was devastating, called dependency confusion, typo squatting, creating packages that are not quite the right names, is still common. And then all sorts of malicious code injection, you know, doing things like stealing a developer's password and using that to inject malicious software. It's not just the number of attacks that are growing. It's quite clear that the impact is growing. Late last year, 2020, the SolarWinds attack on SolarWinds was revealed. Current estimates are a lot of companies, on average, we're going to spend $12 million. And if you total it up with all the impacts on users and what they're going to have to do to address this attack, they're talking about $100 billion. That's a lot of money. That's a lot of money. and you know, SolarWinds is a proprietary software. And anybody who thought, hey, if it's proprietary, that's going to protect us, no, that didn't work. So we need to go beyond that. Inis, as mentioned earlier, that's the European Union Agency for Cybersecurity, have actually, I think, a pretty good rationale of why these attacks are growing in both number and their devastatingness. I'm going to quote a little bit more of the quote here. The better protected against cyber attacks organizations become, attention is shifting towards suppliers who are becoming the weakest link on the supply chain. You know, the attackers are just shifting towards what they now perceive is the weakest link. And unfortunately, the weakest link is, instead of attacking directly the users, let's attack the software while it's being developed or distributed. So the US White House issued an executive order on cybersecurity earlier this year, and they have a whole section specifically about supply chain for software. We, the Linux Foundation, did a survey earlier, and one of the questions was, hey, is your organization considering any changes in response to the US executive order on cybersecurity? And just a little over three quarters, 76%, said yes. It's not, hopefully it's clear, this is not just a US problem, it's a global problem, you know, and this, and Nisa's talking about this also. But you know, clearly there is an increasing awareness that this is a challenge that needs to be addressed. So let me talk to you just a little bit. I sadly don't have enough time to really go into details, but at least give you a little taste, little samples of some of the security challenges and what some of the projects are doing to raise up to those challenges. It's really important that we make sure that our open source software is secure, it's developed securely, both in general, across all open source, and do want to focus especially on some of those really critical projects that are widely depended on. And in addition, we also want to ensure that it's securely distributed. It's great if it's developed in a secure way, but we need to make sure it actually gets the people who are trying to use it. A number of the projects I'm going to be talking about are within the Open Source Security Foundation, the OpenSSF. So I'll just mention that here, and I'll repeatedly mention that throughout. First of all, involving securing software, especially open source software in general. We've done a number of things within the LF. One of the first things that I helped develop here was the Secure Software Development Fundamentals courses. Unfortunately, the vast majority of software developers have never been told how to develop secure software. We are getting exactly the kind of software you would expect. Okay, it's not that they're stupid. Nobody told them this important information. So we now released a set of three courses that are completely free. Go to opensf.org/training/courses and you get some courses. The CIA Best Practices badge is now actually part of the OpenSSF that continues to grow strong. We now have over 4,000 participating projects. Over 600 projects have earned a passing badge, which is great. And this is a set of criteria to encourage the development of, you know, higher quality, higher security software. OpenSSF Scorecard is a project which tries to completely to measure projects in a completely automated way, looking for various heuristics that suggest is this more or less likely to be developing secure software. OpenSSF has developed a vulnerability disclosure guide that I believe is draft, but I think it's about to be released. I do note that all of these mention the importance of automation. Automation is not sufficient to create secure software, but it is necessary. Software is too big to do everything by hand. We do also need to focus work on particular projects, critical projects. And so for that, we basically need to do two things. Identify what's critical, and then implement some focused activities, some focused investments on those particular projects. Of course, that raises some questions. How do we identify critical software? And there's actually been a lot of work in this area. The Linux Foundation has been working with Harvard University to do quantitative analysis. OpenSSF has done some other work, such as criticality score. They've got a whole working group on trying to identify critical software. And then, of course, once you have identified focused investments, the Linux Foundation has been doing focused investments for many years, and we expect that we're going to continue and, I believe, accelerate. The OpenSSF is actually currently talking about a draft proposal called Alpha Omega. I think this is actually going to come to fruition soon, but I think it's worth noting that this is already going on. And in fact, they're thinking about it the same way I just described. It's actually two projects, Alpha and Omega. Alpha is identifying the critical projects and then doing that focused work. In this case, they're talking about deep security work, you know, automated automating tooling, adding best practices, looking for vulnerabilities, proposing fixes. And then for Omega, it's that, you know, something's critical to everyone. So, you know, how do we handle all the projects that where we can't right now focus, have that kind of alpha work? We can at least work on automated tooling, automated triage. Now, once you develop that software, make it secure, you also need to make sure you distribute it securely so that the eventual users get the software they were intending to get. And there's a number of projects that are working to do that. Sigstore is a whole new project to try to make cryptographic signing and verification vastly easier than it has in the past. We've had tools to do cryptographic signing and verification for decades. They're almost never used. I'm aware there are exceptions, but for various reasons, it's very hard to sign, and even worse, to verify. So Sigstore takes a whole different approach for signing code, verifying signatures, and monitoring activity. They're very much inspired by another project, Let's Encrypt. They want to do the same kind of thing. We're making it free to all, easy to all, automate everything. And I think this is very, very promising because, you know, being able to sign things has been technically possible, but too hard for mere mortals in many cases. We need to make this super easy. In Toto, I don't have time to go through that, but that's another project to basically be able to record and verify the processes and the steps that development goes through and distribution goes through. And finally, there's supply chain levels for software artifacts, SALSA. This is a work in progress to identify various criteria for various processes and practices to use to basically make sure that you have integrity in that developed and distributed software. And they have developed four levels, each of which increases the level of protection. So, if you maintain open source software, you're involved in some way with that, I would encourage, first of all, get all the maintainers to learn how to develop secure software. I mentioned the free OpenSSF course. I mean, you don't have to take that course. Take anything. But the vast majority of software developers have not been taught on how to develop secure software. Let's get that fixed. Once you know, it's not rocket science. Okay, there's a lot of basics And they're just basics. And once you learn them, you can use that information, that knowledge that you've gained for the rest of your professional life. If you maintain open source software, get a CI best practices badge. It doesn't take that long. It's essential criteria of things that you should already be doing. Things like, you know, have an automated test suite. You know, use tools to look for vulnerabilities in your source code before you deliver. Have a way to report vulnerabilities back. Hopefully you won't have any, but you know, you should be prepared ahead of time. And just like Kate mentioned earlier for the transparency things, get involved, okay? If you wanna see a more secure world, please get involved. Help us build one. Collaboration is absolutely key to the things that we're talking about today. And hopefully I've at least inspired you to go look into some of these different things, because they are ready and willing to have more people join in and pull all together. So thank you very much.
Thank you.
Okay, thank you very much for attending.
Yep.
Thank you both. Really amazing work. It's a big thing to try and work across hundreds of thousands of open source projects to change development processes, to provide traceability, transparency. You're really doing an amazing job, both of you. Thank you. I'm honored to work with both of you.
Thank you.
All right, that wraps up our keynotes for this morning and for the event. So I hope you all enjoy the rest of the event. And thank you for being here this week. We're kind of slowly but surely, through hybrid and virtual, getting back to some sense of normalcy. I think we're going to kind of continue down this path for at least the near term. Hopefully, in some passing of time, we'll be able to get back together in larger crowds and maybe with less restrictions. But I really appreciate that all of you have come together in this way and worked with us with all the different validation of vaccinations and mask policies and safety policies that we've had. We really, really appreciate it. Don't forget to save the date for our Open Source Summit and ELC next year, Embedded Linux Conf next year, which is June 22nd to the 24th. Puppy Palooza is happening now. That's right, there are puppies on level 4. For those of you who've just been stressed out during COVID, this is an opportunity where you don't get a COVID puppy for yourself, you just get the puppy and all the fun here at Puppy Palooza. I hope to see you all tonight at the Seattle Aquarium at 5:45. Thank you all. Have a great week. So if I'm gonna go